And we are going to continue looking in the book of Revelation, and we're going to be in chapter 4 this morning. And if you have a bulletin, you see that we are going to the throne room of God today. We are actually going to look at heaven a little bit. And we're going to get a glimpse of it. And it's always interesting when you tell people, they say, "What you preaching about, preacher, this Sunday?" And I tell them, "We're going to look at heaven." They get excited. They go, "Oh boy, Myrtle, he's going to talk about heaven this morning." And people get excited. Because people have all kinds of ideas about heaven. We have all kinds of thoughts and we have all kinds of imaginations about heaven. As a matter of fact, David Jeremiah said this. He said, "Many people picture heaven as a never-ending church service in the sky." And people think, oh, no. No, they think it's a never-ending church service in the sky. And I know some people say, "Well, we have a never-ending church service down here sometimes." But he goes on to say, or they think of all, they think we will all become angels who float around heaven on clouds playing harps for the rest of time. Fact is, neither one of these things makes eternity seem very appealing, actually, does it? And both are completely inaccurate according to the Bible. It's interesting when you talk to people what they think heaven is going to be like and how they picture heaven. I've got a family member who thinks heaven is going to be filled with cats. Okay, now if you close your eyes in death and you open them and all of a sudden you're surrounded by cats, I'd be nervous. Okay, if you're a cat lover, send all your emails to the church. I get that, but heaven, people have their different understandings of what heaven's going to be like. What are we going to do in heaven? What's going to happen in heaven? And more often than not, the reality is when we stack those imaginations up next to the truths of Scripture, we're dead wrong. Jeremiah ends his quote by saying, "In fact, heaven will be glorious and full of grandeur. We will experience the fullness of joy as we live in the presence of God and fellowship with each other." Again, heaven is going to be beyond our imagination. The realm of God is involves things, rather, that we cannot even begin to imagine. Paul said in 1 Corinthians that he actually, through a circumstance, got a glimpse of heaven. He said the things he saw, no one can understand or reiterate. No one can share those things. They're just so amazing. But as we open the book of Revelation, and as God reveals Christ to us as he wraps up human history and ends time, we get a glimpse on a few occasions of life and of the situation and scenery in heaven. And we're going to do that this morning. And so again, we're going to be in chapter 4. And you know what the most amazing thing about God is? Is that God invites us to be in heaven with him. Here's the thing. God is perfect. He's majestic. He's omnipresent, omniscient, all-powerful, omnipotent. He is God. He is existence itself. Yet he created us. And even though we sinned and rebelled against him, he still loves us. Isn't that amazing? Not only that, but he wants to spend eternity with us. That's why we just did communion. That's why Jesus came. God took on flesh, entered this world, lived a sinless life. He allowed himself to be taken and crucified, allowed his body to be broken, his blood to be shed. And God experienced death, and he was buried. But 3 days later, he rose again from the dead. He's alive and lives now and invites all who receive Christ as Savior by faith and trust in him to be saved and to spend eternity with him. I sometimes sit down and just reflect on that, and it just blows me away. I'm amazed that Susan wants to spend any time with me, much less God. But that's the reality. And as we come into chapter 4 of Revelation, God yet once again extends an invitation. This time he extends it to John. So as we jump into chapter 4, let's look at the invitation that John receives. Revelation chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, it says, "After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And this voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, 'Come up here! Come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this.'" Again, we saw in the first chapter of Revelation the things which have been. John had seen Jesus in all of his glory. Then in chapters 2 and 3, we did a drone flyover last week of the seven churches that existed in John's day. That is the things that are, he related in Revelation 1:19. The things that have been, the things that are. In John's day, those churches were active and involved. Different characteristics, pluses and minuses. Not much different from our church and churches today. But starting in chapter 4 until the end of the book, he says, "Now I will show you things that will come after this, hereafter." And as we begin to move through this book of Revelation, we are going to begin to look at future events, future things, end times, as you will, even some prophecy. But understand this, we are going to be careful to let the Bible speak for itself. And one of the first places John is invited is to glory. He's invited spiritually to heaven. He gets a glimpse of what's coming concerning God's heavenly home, and specifically the throne room of God. And he brings us along for the trip. And so this morning, you and I are going to get a glimpse of heaven. And here's the thing about it. And other places in Revelation when it talks about heaven, here's the thing about it. It ain't nothing like we think it's going to be. Whatever your thoughts, whatever your preconceptions of heaven, whatever you've seen in movies or read in books or seen painted on pictures in Sunday school classrooms, whatever you think heaven is going to be, it ain't going to match up to what heaven really is like. As a matter of fact, I do have a sermon I preach sometime entitled Three Reasons Why Most Christians Won't Like Heaven. Because we think heaven is going to be a place where maybe some people think, I can play golf all my life, all eternity. Or in heaven, we'll have wings and we can fly and flit about. We talk about when so-and-so passes away, well, they got their wings, they became angels. No, actually, that doesn't work that way. Angels are their own created beings. We're not going to get wings and be like angels. As a matter of fact, we will rule and reign over the angels eventually. Here's the thing. Heaven, as we're going to see, first of all, will be dominated by the presence of Jesus Christ. Heaven is going to, for eternity, Christ, as we're going to see in a moment, he'll be seated on a throne. He'll be the focal point of heaven. Heaven will be dominated by his person and presence. It's amazing how many Christians won't let Christ be dominant in their life today. Why makes you think you're going to enjoy heaven if Jesus isn't Lord of your life now? Secondly, heaven is also going to be saturated with the presence of Almighty God. Every nook and every cranny. The thing about today, he is still omnipresent today. He's everywhere with us now. But it's going to be visible, tangible in heaven. He is going to be everywhere you go. God is going to be there. And the difference between now and there is we're going to see it. We're going to know it in a better and deeper way. Yet how often we try to run from God, even as believers. How often we try to compartmentalize our life. We don't want God in here because we're going to do things that make him mad. We don't want God getting in our way here. Look at all the empty chairs in the church this morning. There are people that don't want God messing with their weekend on Sunday. Yet heaven is going to be saturated with the presence of God. What makes you think you're going to like heaven if you're not saturated with God in your life now? And then finally, heaven is going to be animated with the Spirit, as we're going to see this morning. Now, it's not going to be an eternal church service, but man, we're going to worship in heaven. We're going to worship, we're going to shout, we're going to celebrate in heaven. Years ago, I had a couple of ladies come to my office, as people are wont to do. And they said, "Pastor, we need to talk to you," as people do. And they came in, sat down, and they said, "We have a problem." "Fine, what's your problem?" "We'll see, we can't work out." She goes, "We want you to ask people not to applaud anymore in the worship service." I said, "Wait, beg your pardon?" "We said, we don't want people applauding anymore. We don't want all that clappy stuff." I said, "Why?" They said, "It's just so disconcerting. It just upsets us. We like everything quiet and calm." And as graciously as I could, I told them, ladies, then you're not going to like heaven. Because heaven's going to be a flat-out celebration. We're going to clap. We're going to shout. We're going to scream. We're going to celebrate. We're going to sing. Heaven is going to be animated. And if you don't like that now, you're going to have a problem. So let's look at heaven and see what it's actually like. John is invited. He's been called up. There's an open door. And listen, there's an open door right now for anybody who would like to one day go to heaven. Jesus himself in the book of John says, I am the door to heaven. He is the door. Jesus said in John 14, no one comes to the Father, he said, but by me. John's open door is just a reminder of the open door that we all have. If we would walk through it, God has opened it through Jesus. Jesus is the door. We just commemorated his death on the cross. It is when we acknowledge that death and own that death for us, we believe he died for us. We are sinners. We are lost. We need salvation. When we place our faith and confidence in him as our Savior, that's the door. Because God has invited us, come up and see. You can know you're going to heaven right now through faith in Christ. But John is getting that invitation. There's an opening door, a welcoming voice. Come on up. Come on up. Come on in. Don't you love it when you go visit somebody and knock on the door? You open, they're glad to see you. Hope they are. And they say, come on in. And you're coming in while their wife or husband is in the background putting everything away, okay? But you're coming in. That won't happen in heaven. Everything's good in heaven. But that's the invitation that chapter 4 starts with. Chapter 4 begins with that, come on up. And the door is open, and Christ is the door. And if you'll trust him, one day you will walk into heaven when you close your eyes into this world. So that's what we see first. Come on up here. Come up here. And so he's been invited into heaven, and he enters the throne room of God. Oh, my goodness. Have you ever been somewhere where the sight of it just takes your breath away? Just blows you away. Just you're so amazed. I love it when I go to the mountains. And just to stand on one of those overlooks and see the grandeur of all the natural beauty in the mountains and look at that. Or would you stand, when I was growing up, we lived near the Gulf of Mexico, just to go out on the Gulf and just look at the splendor of the ocean. It's amazing. One of my memories is when we were on a mission trip in New York City several years ago. Before these buildings were horrendously taken out, several of us went up to the top of one of the World Trade Towers and looked at New York City at night. And that was a beautiful sight. All the beautiful lights, the cityscape, it was breathtaking. Imagine opening your eyes and you're in the throne room of Almighty God. John, under the inspiration of the Spirit, is going to seek to explain it to us, but even his explanation doesn't, I'm sure, do it justice. So why are we looking at it? Because we need to look at it this morning to see the grandeur of our God. To see the magnificence of Almighty God and what is awaiting us as we get to heaven. And as we go into this throne room, the first thing John sees and shares with us is the throne of God itself. And we see, first of all, the great opulence of this throne, the fanciness, the magnificence of this throne. He says in verse 2, immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one who sat on the throne. And he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardius stone in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne in the appearance of an emerald. And so as we see this throne, first of all, he sees not only the throne, but the occupant of the throne. It's an opulent throne. It's glorious. It's magnificent. Around the throne, John says, is something like a rainbow. But rather than many colors, it's different shades of emerald green. My dad did jewelry as a hobby. My dad, he called himself a lapidaritist. I told that somebody, they said, what church is that? I said, that's not a church. That's somebody who collects gemstones and rocks, and my dad did. He had a whole jewelry thing in his workshop where he made jewelry. And a couple of times he was able to get real emeralds. And there's nothing like looking at a real emerald. It's just beautiful, the richness and the clarity and the texture of that rich green color. You know, often we think of heaven as being gray and white, or maybe to change it up, white and gray. And we see it all floaty clouds and robed angels and everything else, but already we're seeing explosions of color. The throne of Christ will be surrounded by emerald, the color of emeralds of a rainbow. And then on the throne will be God himself in Christ. Jesus Christ, as we'll see later, the Lamb of God will be sitting on the throne. And it says, he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardius. A jasper stone, more often than not, was a flesh-colored stone. Different gradients, different variants of flesh color, either very dark brown or very light tan. And it seemed to represent not only it had red tones to it, and oftentimes it has brown. It seems to radiate the whole color scheme of human existence and human flesh, no matter what the ethnicity or the race is. Because sardius stones come in various shades and various tones, but generally they have that same undertone of like human flesh. And he talks about the sardius stone, which was like a ruby. I've seen those in real life too. Rich, deep red. Rich, deep red color and hue. And it puts us in mind of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. His body, his flesh that was broken, and the rich, deep redness of the blood that was shed. It's interesting that as John saw Christ on the throne, these are the colors that struck him. It seems like all the way from the early books of Genesis till the latter book of Revelation, we were reminded of Jesus Christ one way or another, and specifically his broken body and his shed blood. And John just is taking in this sight. It's an amazing thing. It reminds us that Jesus Christ is, in fact, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he is the dominant person in heaven. People often say, well, heaven will be heaven with me if Aunt Mary's there. Heaven will be heaven for me if Cousin Fred or Sister Joyce or whatever. Heaven will be heaven because this has happened, or I can do this or I can be that. I'll tell you what will make heaven heaven. Jesus Christ will be there. His broken body. The Bible tells us that even in heaven we'll see the wounds on his hands and his feet. By the way, that is the only man-made thing that will be in heaven, are the wounds in the body of Christ. Even as in his glorified body, he displays those wounds. And so as John sees him, he sees him ensconced in this opulent throne of emerald green. And he sees the flesh-colored jasper and the ruby-colored sardius. And that's what we will see one day when we stand before the throne of Almighty God. And then he begins to see the throne room. Because again, the first thing that's going to catch his attention, the first thing that's going to catch our attention when we go to be before God is God himself in the center. But then once we take in that sight to the best of our ability, then we'll begin to look around and see the throne room. And John continues to describe the throne room. First, he tells us what's going on around the throne as we pick it up. He says in verse 4, around the throne, there were 24 thrones. And on those thrones, I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their heads. Who are these elders, and what is that about? Well, there's been a lot of discussion about that, but these are elders who are righteous, and their righteousness comes from Christ. Because elsewhere in Revelation, we find that when we're clothed in white, that's because Christ has washed us clean from our sin. And we'll be wearing white robes in heaven. We'll be enjoying that righteous attire. 24, why 24? Well, it's been speculated that these elders are representative of the 12 tribes of Israel. and the 12 apostles of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so we see the span of God's story from Old Testament to New Testament. And these elders were raised because of their faithfulness, because of their walk with Christ, to reign with Him and to sit with Him. Jesus told His disciples that one day they would be enthroned with Him. You remember, James and John argued who was going to sit next to Him. It's interesting that John didn't say, "It was me." Okay. He didn't. He just mentioned the 12 different guys on one side, the 12 different guys on the other side. Their righteousness reflecting the righteousness of Christ. He says in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, "Come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they will be made," what? "White as snow." And so he goes on to describe this scene as we continue. He says in verse 5, "And from the throne room proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices." Lightnings and thunderings and voices. There's going to be all kinds of stuff happening. There are going to be thunderous sounds. No, heaven's not going to be a quiet, boring place. Heaven is going to be loud and dramatic. Lightnings, thunderings, voices. Those voices, as we're going to see next week in chapter 5, they're going to be singing and shouting glory to God. Heaven is not going to be a dull, quiet, boring place. That's why I'm saying if you're worshiping God in church, sing out, shout, applaud the Lord, you know, clap, celebrate. In the Old Testament, the Jews had many feast days in the year. Interestingly enough, out of those feast days, 20% of those involved guilt offerings or offerings for sin, but 80% of those feasts and 80% of those feast days were for celebration. Somehow we feel guilty if we celebrate. Somehow we feel like it's irreverent if we celebrate. There's nothing wrong with getting excited about Christ. There's nothing wrong. I'll be honest with you. Some Sundays I wish we'd blow the roof off this place. Doesn't bother me a bit. Pastor, it gets loud. Bring cotton. Get excited. You got something to be excited about. If you can't get excited now, you're going to not like heaven much. I could see us walking around heaven doing this. It's not going to happen. There'll be thunderous sounds. And not only that, God's Spirit, again, He will be animating this. Look what it says. It says, as we continue in verse 5, there'll be from the throne thunderings, lightnings, and voices. Seven lamps of fire will be burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Or better Greek translation from the Greek, the sevenfold spirit of Almighty God, the Holy Spirit. So in the throne room, we will experience the majesty of God, the lordship of Christ, and the Spirit of God will be our worship leader. That's going to be exciting, y'all. It's going to be exciting. It's going to be great. That's what's going around the throne. He then moves us to what is going to be going on before the throne. Before the throne, he mentions a couple of things. First of all, he describes the physical layout of it a little bit more. It says in verse 6, "Before the throne, there was a sea of glass, like crystal." A sea of glass like crystal. I cannot stand before you and say, "Well, that has a spiritual meaning. It means X, Y, and Z." I don't know, because the Bible doesn't say. It is simply a physical description of what is going to be going on. Around that throne, there's going to be some kind of sea that is so pure it's like glass, reflecting the light of heaven, reflecting and sparkling in the glory of God. It's going to be amazing. Now, the Bible does talk about the fact that out of the nations of the world or out of the waters of the world, Revelation often talks about the nations and the peoples of the world as waters. Usually that symbolism is used. That out of the waters or nations of the world, God has called His church. Is that what this is symbolizing? I don't know. All I do know is the Bible says around that throne is going to be spectacular. Before that throne is going to be the vast sea. So this gives you somewhat of the expanse of this throne room. But then it goes on to even get more interesting as we go through it. Because, listen, when you think of angelic creatures, you think of that pretty Irish woman that was on that program. What was it? Touched by an Angel. And she would often appear glowing in a light, wearing white and all these things. But you know what? Angels, by the way, angels in the Bible, there are no female angels in the Bible. Angels, whenever they appeared as men. There aren't any female angels, and don't get upset because angels aren't human. They're angels. They're not like us, and we're not like them, other than when they manifest in appearance. But they're also angelic beings other than what we think of as angelic messengers, as we see in Scripture. The book of Isaiah talks to us about seraphim, a different type of angelic creature, with six wings that fly. Now, these have wings. And as they flit about the throne room of God, they protect and defend the very holiness of Almighty God. The Bible also speaks of another class of angels known as the cherubim or the cherubs. Now, here's where Western culture gets in our way. Because we're getting ready to head for Valentine's Day soon. And you'll see on different Valentine's cards, I hate Valentine's Day, by the way, no offense, but I just think it's tacky, okay? My wife knows I loved her. I told her I'd love her when I married her, and if anything ever changed, I'd let her know, okay? No, it's not that bad. I tell her I love her very frequently. But Hallmark has invented a day whereby we spend a lot of money to tell someone that we should already be telling them as we live our lives with them. But oftentimes on these Valentine cards, you see this fat little baby with curly hair and wings and a bow and arrow. And that's a cherub. No, it's not. The book of Ezekiel describes these creatures in certain ways, and the cherubim take on somewhat different appearance. And these may be talking about cherubim here because we can relate them to the creatures in Ezekiel. But let's look at them a minute. Get ready, and it says as we continue, and in the midst of the throne and around the throne were four living creatures. Four living creatures. Now, here's the thing. Get a load of this description. Full of eyes in front and in back. You know, growing up wearing glasses, I was called four eyes, and it used to bother me. Now I got creatures I can identify with. They were full of eyes, which represented the all-knowing omniscience of Almighty God. God sees and knows everything. It goes on to describe them in verse 7. The first living creature was like a lion. The second living creature like a calf. The third living creature had a face like a man. And the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. This is similar to the description of the living creatures, a little bit difference, a little bit of nuance from Ezekiel to this book. And it's interesting, many Bible scholars, and I agree with them, believe that these representations most likely, you can speculate, but most likely represent the facets of Jesus Christ himself. The face of the lion displays the royalty of Christ. Lions were always depicted as royal animals, the king of the beasts. And often kings and queens demonstrated their reign through lion imagery. As a matter of fact, the book of Matthew is known as the Gospel of the King. Jesus comes off as the king of his kingdom, and that was exactly what he is. The next is the face of a calf. A calf or an oxen is a beast of burden. It's a servant animal. And the Bible tells us that Jesus didn't come to be served when he first came, but he came to serve. As a matter of fact, the Gospel of Mark portrays Jesus as a servant. Unlike the Gospel of Matthew, where there are long discourses and sermons, the Gospel of Mark is a brief gospel. And the key word in the Gospel of Mark is immediately, immediately, immediately. See, with servants, they're never allowed to sit. They're never allowed to rest. They're always going, always going. And Jesus is the servant. He came to serve, not to be served. He came to seek and to save that which is lost. He goes on to say, as he describes the next one, he says it has a face like a man. Well, the Gospel of Luke portrays Jesus as the Son of Man. That's the common title of Christ in the Gospel of Luke. And in the Gospel of Luke, we see much more description of Jesus' birth, for instance. his genealogy. He even records in an episode when Jesus was 12 years old. We see a lot of aspects of Jesus' humanity. He was fully God and fully man. We see Jesus' humanity on display in the book of Luke. And then, of course, the book of John, above all the other three Gospels, portrays the divinity of Christ from the very beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John puts Jesus' divinity on display, and an eagle in Middle Eastern times was symbolic of God and of an eagle, of divinity. And so it can be argued that these four living creatures, these angelic beings who look so odd and unexpected, actually describe the different facets of our Savior Jesus Christ and his ministry. Describe his ultimate majesty and deity in that many eyes he sees all and knows all. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords. He is the divine servant who obediently died on the cross for us. He is also a man, fully man and fully God, so we could relate to him. And yet he is God, and he is at the same time the only door of heaven. And so these are the angelic creatures that we will see in heaven. Heaven is already not what we expected it, is it? As you look at this description, never once have you sat down and pictured a creature looking like one of these individuals with eyes and all these features. And so we see these four living creatures here, these angelic beings. Now listen, heaven is going to be populated with all sorts. Heaven is going to be populated with all the saved from the Old Testament to the New, from the beginning until the end. People from all nations, people from all ethnicities who have come to know Christ. That is the universal church. Not only that, but the Old Testament Jews, like Abraham, it says Abraham believed God and he counted it to him for righteousness. The Old Testament Jews who trusted in the coming Messiah, who understood that the lamb that was offered in their sacrifice was a picture of the ultimate lamb who would take away their sin. You see, people in the Old Testament were saved by faith in the coming Messiah. We are saved by faith in the Messiah who has come and will come again. So it's going to be a place. It's going to be a party. Yes, there's going to be a reunion. And so that's what's going on as we look at the things before the throne. So you'll see a sea of glass, and you'll see these living creatures around the throne or elders, 24 elders representative of the different people in the scripture. And then you'll hear the wonderful thunderings and voices and shoutings. It's going to be amazing. And here we come to the worship of heaven. There are a lot of Christians that skip church these days. They have better things to do. They have more important, or they were too tired to get up on Sunday morning. I'll tell you, if you don't like worship now, and hey, let me say this, I understand some churches can be boring. Some things can be dead. Some churches are so dead, you've heard it said that if somebody had a heart attack, it would take paramedics an hour and a half to dig through everybody to find them. So we sometimes do get but see, this is the reason why, is that church is generally not excited about Almighty God. But man, heaven is not going to be that way. Let's look at the worship here for a second. First of all, as we look at the worship, we're going to see three things. That our worship here, if we want to emulate what goes on in heaven, this is what we need to do here as we think of worship. And by the way, the word worship is from an old English derivative, worth-ship. And that's what actually, there are many words in the Greek for worship in the New Testament. One of the main ones literally speaks of worthiness. And that God is worthy of our attention. God is worthy of our praise. He's worthy of our devotion. He's worthy of our sacrifice. And because of the way the old English translators translated its scripture and came up with their language, they would refer to the time that we gather on Sunday as worship. That it was worth being there. It was worth assembling. It was worth honoring God, worth giving him the glory. And then that word morphed into worship, and that's what we call what we do today. And then after a while, we began to talk about the worship service. I've never liked that title, worship service. Worship sounds great. Service, not so much. What we do, I prefer worship gathering or worship celebration. Because we gather to honor God and to demonstrate his worth. And in this worship, we're going to see how they honor the holiness of God. They're going to demonstrate humility before God. And they're going to celebrate the worthiness of God. Let's look at it. So these living creatures, they're going to be there, and they're going to be our worship leaders. Where's Brooks? Okay. I want to see Brooks with many eyes in the face of a lion. There you are. All right. They're going to be leading this worship. It says in verse 8, the four living creatures, each having six wings and full of eyes around and within. They also have these wings. And they're going to be just, man, they're going to be unusual, strange looking. Mike looks pretty normal, but they're going to look unusual and strange. And it goes on to say, and they do not rest day and night. Now, it's not going to be an endless worship service or church service in heaven. No, no. But heaven is going to be all about worthiness and worshiping of Almighty God. Notice it says, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Now you know where the hymn writer got those words. These angels and the saints of heaven are going to be shouting, holy, holy, holy to God. The word holy means distinct, set apart, worthy of our honor. When you come on Sunday morning, is God holy? Are you coming here to proclaim the holiness of Almighty God, or is it all about you? I love what Christian teacher Francis Chan once told to somebody. They came up to him one time and said, I didn't like the worship service this morning. And he said, that's all right, it wasn't for you anyway. Our job is to come here and give glory and honor to God, to demonstrate His worthiness and His holiness. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We will be extolling the holiness of God for eternity. Now notice as we move into verse 9, it says, whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to Him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, notice the 24 elders fall down before Him who sits on the throne, and worship Him who lives forever and ever. And look what it says, and cast their crowns before the throne. There's humility in heavenly worship. Even in heaven, even in worship in heaven, there's going to be humility as these elders and the rest of the saints will bow down before Almighty God. And notice what they do. They take those crowns and they cast them at His feet. You know, the Bible talks about crowns as being part of the reward that we'll experience in heaven for faithful service to Him. And everybody says, ooh, I'm trying for that crown. I'm going to get a jewel in the crown. I don't never remember where it talks about jewels in the crown. But we have that kind of parlance going on. But you know what you're going to do with that crown in heaven? Here's why some people are going to be bothered, maybe. Because you're going to cast it at His feet. Because heaven's not about you and I either. It's about God. It's about Christ, animated by His Spirit. Do we get that humble as we worship on Sunday morning? When was the last time on Sunday morning we gathered and we cast our lives before Him? We cast ourselves before Him. We cast our talents, time, and treasures before Him. That's what happens when true worship goes on. There's a recognition of God's holiness. And then there's a humbleness as we gather and saying, God, we're so full of God, we're so worshiping God, we're so honoring Him, that all we can do is cast our lives before Him. So heaven is going, that worship in heaven is going to involve the holiness of God, humility before God, and then we're going to sing and shout about the worthiness of God. Look what it says as we finish up here. He says in verse 11, as they throw the crowns before Him, they're going to say, you are worthy, O Lord. That's worship. You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created.
Here's what I found.
That's what he found. See, even my watch knows about this. But we will one day honor Him and in a sense understand that everything that you and I have, everything that you and I think is important, everything that you and I cherish, it all belongs to Him anyway, including that which looks back at you in the mirror. Yet we hold it back. We come on Sunday morning, I can't wait till the preacher's done and I can go home, get my biscuit or my meatloaf. I wish he would be quiet. I don't like worship. It's just too long. I wish he would. And we get, they need help in this ministry. They need hands in that ministry. Boy, I hope somebody comes and does it. It's sad that the church has to beg people to do ministry. I'm going to tell you what, because one day in heaven, you're going to toss it all at his feet. So if you want to really enjoy heaven, if you want to experience heaven, here's what you do. Here's what we should do. We should come here on Sunday morning breaking our necks to get here. Unless we're providentially hindered by absolute necessity of work or physical ailment, or we're just, even if you're somewhere else, hey, they got churches at the beach. Really? Yeah. We should be here, whatever it takes, worshiping Almighty God. Why? For no other reason, he's worth it. Humbling ourselves before him and casting everything we have at his feet. God, I'll do whatever you need me to do. Just use me. That's what's going to happen in heaven. If you can't handle it now, we're in trouble. You're in trouble. So as John describes to us the throne room, the center of that throne room is going to be Jesus. And around that throne will be spectacular sights and colors and sounds. There'll be singing and shouting, thunderous sounds. They'll be worshiping and unusual-looking creatures who will be giving God glory as they represent his majesty. And God's people will be worshiping him, humble before him, proclaiming his witness. I like what A.W. Tozer said. He said, I can safely say, on the authority of all that is revealed in the Word of God, that any man or woman on this earth who is bored and turned off by worship is not ready for heaven. So we end on this note. Solomon, when he was experimenting with life, he was trying to fulfill the desire and the yearnings of his soul. And he was wealthy. He's one of the wealthiest men that ever lived. And he bought stuff and built stuff. He had thousands of wives, 700 wives, 300 concubines. You name it, that would fulfill a human desire, a human lust, he did it and could do it. But one of the things he noticed as he did this, in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, he said, he has made everything beautiful in its time. And notice this next line, and he has put eternity in their hearts, except that no one can find out the work that God has done from beginning to end. What does he mean by that? That longing you have in your spirit that you try to fill with materialism, you try to fill with relationships, you try to fill with experiences, that is your homesickness for eternity. You're desiring more than what you have. You're desiring something better than what you see. And the reality is, Solomon found it out, John found it out, this world isn't going to satisfy you. Only God can. And if you're worshiping the way God intends us to worship, if you're honoring him, here's what C.S. Lewis said as we finish. He said, if I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. That's the idea. You and I were made for another world. We were created and saved, if you're saved, to worship God, to honor God, to focus upon God, to give God the glory. And if you're anticipating heaven, oh, I can't wait to get to heaven. I wish God would blow the trumpet. I'm ready to go now. What do you think it's going to be like? We just saw a glimpse of it. One last time, it is going to be dominated by the person of Jesus Christ. If your life isn't dominated by the person of Jesus Christ, I'd be praying about that. It's going to be saturated with the presence of the God the Father. He's going to be in everywhere, and it's going to be tangible and visible. Is your life saturated with God the Father? Or do you shove him aside and only go find him when you need him or if it's convenient? And finally, listen, heaven is going to be animated with the worship of Almighty God, the praise of Almighty God. It's going to be something. And this is what you need to understand. And your heart, that's what it's longing for. All the things you buy, all the experiences you go, all the vacations, there's nothing wrong with buying things and going on vacation. But if you're expecting that to make your life happy, you're a miserable person. You were created to worship God. That yearning in you is a yearning for God. That cavity in you can only be filled with God. And so God is inviting us to go. And even the book of Hebrews, God is inviting us to his throne room. He says in the book of Hebrews that we can come before his throne, seek mercy and help in time of need. The invitation is there. The door is open. And God is looking at West Concord Baptist Church this morning and say, come and see. Come and see.